Hilmi spent 15 years in varied aspects of the television news and documentary production, and was also a member of the International Association of Women in Radio and Television. Ma'am, we welcome you.
Our moderator for the politics panel, Professor Sumantra Bose, is a faculty of international comparative politics at the London School of Economics. He specializes in the study of ethnic and national concepts and their management, with a particular focus on the Indian subcontinent and the former Yugoslavia. We now hand over the stage to Professor Bose to moderate the panel discussion. So, please.
I'm especially happy that we have such a beautiful panel, and my compliments to the organizers for assuring that. Let's remember that Barack Obama became president at the age of 47, after just 3 years of being the junior senator for Illinois. Tony Blair became prime minister for the first time at the age of 44, and currently we have a 40-something prime minister in Canada, who's been making waves in India lately, and have a 30-something prime minister in New Zealand, who's a woman as well. The organizers have selected three themes for this panel, and in chronological order, they are women in politics in contemporary India, second, nationalism, the meaning of, or I should say in the plural, the meanings of nationalism in India today. And thirdly, quite fittingly as well, youth as change makers, and the challenges that youth face in India today. I'm going to sit down at this stage, and I thought I would kick off the discussion by posing a question to our panelists. The bill to reserve one-third of the seats in the Lok Sabha and in all the state assemblies has been, as they say in Indian English, hanging fire for more than 20 years now. It's 22 years, if I'm not mistaken. I'd like to begin by asking our panelists why, in their opinion, this piece of legislation has proved so difficult to enact. Why is it that it has been stalled, despite apparent, by and large, cross-party support for more than two decades? Maybe we can go in reverse order. There's no order as such, but we can start with Mr. Sindhia, then Ms. Marlena, and then Ms. Ilmi.
Well, thank you very much, Professor. It's wonderful to be here at LSE and interact with not only yourself, but also a group of youngsters here. I had the good fortune of interacting with some of you before we stepped in, and it really takes me back to my days at college and university, which was many, many moons ago. I won't tell you how many moons ago, but nevertheless, it's great being here at LSE, an institution that has really impacted lives of people globally. So it's something that I've been looking forward to for a long time. So thank you for having me. On the topic of the Women's Reservation Bill, I'd just like to go back a little bit and say this, that first of all, I'm really happy today that on this panel, I am the minority. I'm the 33%, and we've got 67% ladies here. But I think the idea of women in parliament is not a new idea in India. Going back to our freedom movement, there were pioneering women that led the charge in that freedom movement with the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi. Sarojini Naidu, to Aruna Asif Ali, to Sucheta Kriplani, who then went on to become the first chief minister of the largest state in India, the size of pretty much the size of Europe in many ways, Uttar Pradesh. And more recently in the past, whether it be the leader of the opposition when the Congress was in government, Sushma Swaraj, the leader of the Congress party, Sonia Gandhi, our first speaker in Parliament, our woman speaker in Parliament, Meera Kumar, our current speaker, Mrs. Sumitra Mahajan, many women in the cabinet in India. So it's not an idea that is new in India. But I do believe that we as a nation, if we have aspirations to become the global power, we cannot do that unless 50% of our population is empowered equally as much as men are. And I think that thought also goes back, not as you said, 20, 21 years, but in fact, close to about 30 years ago, when in 89, our former Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi actually thought of the Women's Reservation Bill and empowering women. At that point of time, it wasn't possible, but again in 93, started bottom-up through reservation for women in panchayats and local bodies, which has today thrown up tremendous amount of leadership. And I represent a rural constituency in India at the grassroots level. We then moved the Women's Reservation Bill in 2010, as you probably, a lot of you are aware of. We pushed it through the upper house, but we could not push it through the lower house because many parties, including the principal opposition party at that time, the BJP, didn't support us in that effort. Now the BJP is in government with a group majority, 280 in the lower house, not in majority in the upper house, but we have many a time push the current Prime Minister to move forward with that bill, because we will support that bill in the upper house when it comes through. I think it is an idea whose time has not come but is way overdue. Just in terms of data points, because you are an economics professor, today we have 64 lady members in the lower house of the 543, which is roughly about 11%. And similarly, in the upper house, we have about close to 27 women members, which is again about 10 to 11%. That by no means, I believe, is commensurate enough in either of the houses. So I think it's an idea whose time is way overdue, but I also do believe that it's a signaling process, but also empowerment must start bottom up with moves like the panchayat system, where reservation has been brought about in local self-bodies, and also women blazing the trail in many, many other walks of life, which we as a country, and I as an Indian, am extremely proud of. So I think it's an idea which must be pushed and promulgated, and I think that onus today lies with the current government. Our leader, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, has written to the Prime Minister many a time saying, please bring it forward so we can push it through.
Can I append something to my question before I give to Ms. Malvina? That is this, I've just been prompted more than anything else. Is this reservation formula, one third rotating Lok Sabha seats, one third rotating seats in the state assemblies, is this necessarily the best way of enhancing women's participation in politics, which I think we all agree is a very urgent imperative? But is this the best way? Mr. Sindhia has just mentioned, and he's absolutely right, that many states now have up to 50% reservation in panchayat government and also in urban local bodies. So we have some lessons from that as to the impact. So I just wanted to tweak my question a little bit, but it's over to you now. Ms. Malaya.
Thank you so much, Professor. And thank you so much to LSE for having all of us here. I think I would actually sort of beg to differ a bit from Mr. Sindhia in terms of this assessment of what he said so far. While I do agree that there have been a lot of women trailblazers, and I think there's a lot of women trailblazers sitting in the audience here as well, but I think that what you see in politics is actually a reflection of what society is. And the reality of our society is that we are a very unequal society. And while there may be a lot of young women who are sitting here who are studying at LSE, and while there may be a majority of us in the panel, the reality still is that there is a lot of women in the country who are still struggling to enter school. There's a lot of women in the young women in the country who are struggling to complete school. There's a lot of young women who are struggling to enter colleges after they have completed school. And why just women who are living in villages or are from the lower sections of society? Even amongst my own friends, I see that women who have studied at institutions, maybe like LSE, maybe like Oxford, are struggling to balance their lives between their families and their careers. And so I think it's this reality of an unequal country that reflects in our politics as well. So I think that while we do have parliamentarians who are women, while we do have well-known historical figures who are women, I think that we cannot deny that it is an extremely unequal society that we come from. And the fact that the Women's Reservation Bill has not passed for the past 20 years is a reflection of that. I think that it's one of those things that everyone talks about, oh yes, we agree with it. Who doesn't agree with it? Who can, in front of a sort of audience, say that, no, I do not believe in the empowerment of women? But the reality is that in this patriarchal society, and in a society, in politics that is dominated predominantly by men, no political party actually wants to pass the Women's Reservation Bill. Because I think that one thing you can say for certain about democracy is that whatever things that affect people's politics, whatever affects their chances of getting re-elected, politicians do. And the fact that something has not happened for 20 years, despite all parties theoretically agreeing on it, is, I think, a good enough proof of the fact that no one actually wants it to happen. And I think that I actually agree with Mr. Sindhya in the fact that what he was talking about in reservation for the panchayats, I actually think that that is probably the way things are actually going to transform. Because I don't think that anyone gets rights by someone giving them to you. I think that women are going to have to fight it out. And I think that fight really has to be built from the bottom upwards. And till, I mean, why is it that we do have reservation for certain groups even in the electoral process? Is because they are an organized political force. And I think that until women become an organized political force, until they demand that right for themselves, right now we are sort of expecting that we are going to lobby with male-dominated political parties, and they would be benign enough or kind enough to give this reservation. I think that anyone who has studied history knows that nothing comes without a struggle. And I would say that it is women who really need to become an organized political force, and there's so many young women sitting here, and that is what I hope would be the future of the women leadership that emerges, maybe out of LSE and from the Indian youth as well. That we have to build ourselves into an organized political force, that no one can deny us that right, that it is not up to someone else to be benign, to be kind to us, and to give that right.
Is that a reality check, maybe? Ms. Umi.
Yes, thank you so much, Professor. Thank you so much, LSE Forum, for inviting us here, and for your tenacity and persistence in managing to get us into this big freeze. So really, good marks to you. You'll make great leaders. I think it's, I agree mostly with both my co-panelists, some corrections there. Whilst I agree with Mr. Sindhya, my friend and co-panelist who talks about Panchayati Raj, and I think that was singularly transformative in the way women see themselves and the way the skewed male-female dynamics in the country is, keeping in mind the social indices where we know that it's not just a patriarchal society but also misogynistic in many different ways. Whether you look at female infanticide, dowry deaths, the representation of women as landholders, and many such factors, you realize that it's highly unequal. However, it was in 1996 that David Bora mooted this idea, and that when it came about. And in 1998, it was introduced by none other than the former Prime Minister, Mr. Vajpayee. After which, the bill was introduced thrice. And there was this rare moment in the Parliament where Sushma Swaraj, along with Sonia Gandhi and Brinda Karat, were seen hand in hand talking about it. It was more or less from these regional parties who talked about quota within a quota, who talked about a special reservation for the OBCs. So they talked about, just like there is a creamy layer within the OBCs, they talked about you know, a quota within the women's reservation system earmarked for Muslim women, for Dalit women, and for scheduled castes, which became a point of contention because of which the bill could not have passed. BJP has stood by it, and I must say, Congress has always supported it. So these two national parties, I must say, have been there, quite there with it. But it's almost many other members of both the parties who have not agreed with it, not the party leaders, but RJD, and you know the famous statement of Sharad Yadav, that you don't want par kati mahilai, you know. Women in shorts hair should not enter parliament. I don't know what difference that makes, but well, it was a huge problem for him, a hairstyle and a hairdo. So, of all the things. So that's where we stand. And this is, we're talking about a senior politician of our country. And that is symptomatic of what we believe in as a society. So while we have people there in the field of politics, leaders who won election after election, but they do not realize the importance of gender parity, gender justice. And that indeed is unfortunate. Prime Minister Modi's cabinet has 25% women representation, while the representation of women overall is only 16% in the state legislatures and parliament. So it's a huge shift. For the first time, we have the defense minister or the external affairs minister, really important, not malleable, sweet, coy ministries, but tough, hard-nailed ministries being run by women. We have Nirmala Sitharaman, we have Sushma Swaraj, we have Smriti Irani, who are really out there, cracking the whip literally, and I'm happy about that. Not just that, within the BJP itself, organizationally, I must tell you this, there were these recommendations made in 2008, I think, by Sushma Swaraj, on the basis of which there has to be 33% reservation within the party organization amongst all offices to be held by women at the central level and state level. So within the party, there is a mandatory 33% reservation for women to occupy posts. So you see a huge number of women in the party offices, so to speak. Yes, I have a different point of view. I think we're largely patriarchal as a nation. And to me, handsome is what handsome does. It's not enough or suffice for a woman to do work with gender. I think there are a lot of patriarchal women who are a repository of patriarchal thought. And there are many men who actually work for women and don't believe in gender biases. If you see Nitish Kumar, if you see the Prime Minister, the kind of work that is being done for women empowerment, and I think that is not the responsibility of just the women legislators or lawmakers, it's as much the responsibility of all parliamentarians and MLAs and all law enforcers to ensure gender parity and justice. Because that is a mandate of the Constitution, the social contract that we've all signed. So I think a lot needs to be done, not just at the level of parliament, but more. And I think Panchayati Raj has been, and the reservation, I think the 123rd Amendment, right, has really led to huge changes at the grassroots level for women.
You know, I'm from West Pudong, and I happen to know politics there very well. And there, the 50% reservation in panchayats and in urban, you know, local bodies as well, has had an impact despite the initial, you know, skepticism of many. So maybe that's the way to go. I mean, build up, you know, grassroots capacity. But I think the stalled saga of the women's bill does illustrate a deeper malaise in the way our polity is constituted. Mrs. Sandhya.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
move on to the next theme, but please go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm going to agree and disagree with some of the stuff that my co-panelists have talked about. I do believe that fighting for the cause of the women's reservation bill or women's empowerment is not only the domain of women in my country, it's also the domain of us men. So I do not agree that women need to alone, by themselves only, fight for their cause. I think men need to do that as well. And I mentioned to you, I come from a rural constituency. The whole concept of the reservation system in panchayats and local bodies, you have a sarpanch who's a mahila, but it's the pati who handles everything. Okay? You have a mahapaur who's the mahila, but it's the pati that handles everything. And when I have seen that happen over the last 16 years that I have been a public servant, on any of my munch, I have moved the men back and I have said, you're not the one who's been elected. It's your wife. She has to be out there and she has to speak for her rights. And many of the women, when given an opportunity, have, as Atishi said, have trailblazed. Right? So I think it's a responsibility of every citizen in the country, not only women themselves. Number one. Number two, I heard my good friend Sazia talk about, you know, cabinet ministers in the current government. I mean, every cabinet has had women. Okay, so it's not only this government.
It's the highest. And
let me finish. Okay, I'm not giving you credit. Okay, I'm not giving you credit. The first defense minister was a woman in India was Indira Gandhi. She was defense minister twice, not once, but twice. Okay, so every cabinet has had women. If you are actually pushing for the cause of women, why is the BJP not bringing the women's reservation bill to parliament? We are saying we're going to support it. You don't need anyone's support in the Lok Sabha because you have a majority. In the Rajya Sabha, you need support. We are saying we're not going to stand with you. We will stand in front of you for this bill. So what's the delay about? It's been 4 years already. Right?
What stops you from bringing the bill yourself? You're a private member.
No, hold on. You're in government. You have to bring the bill. You cannot say everything. Okay, so I don't want to say this with Shazia because she's a good friend, but everything cannot be done looking in the rearview mirror. Right? And private member's bill is not the way the women's reservation bill has to be passed. It has to be a constitutional move. And it's a bill that has been drafted. It's a bill that has been passed in the upper house. It's just waiting to be passed in both the houses. So we need to
just
move on.
Just like the
Triple Talaq
bill is waiting to be passed in the, in the Rajya Sabha.
Can I exercise
so,
right?
So let just... Thirdly, I do believe that we've got to also move away from only gender issues. And I think as public servants, when you look, I believe that my role as a public servant is not about politics alone. Because to me, like probably many of you in this hall, there is a lot of negative elements attached to the thought of politics. To me, it's much more about development. And therefore, when I try and push new paradigms and new projects in my constituency or areas that I'm very, very attached to in my state, it's about development for all. So let me give you two quick examples. One, probably some of you will connect with this, but the famous Chanderi sari fabric comes from my constituency in Pune. And so today we've set up the largest hand loom park in Asia, in Chanderi. And the reason I did that is because when I walked into houses in Chanderi and I would see men and women weaving with the looms, and in India it's called Tana Bana, you know, the walk and the weft, right? Inside their houses. So they had two bedroom tenements. The children and the parents would live in one room together. And the second room would be where the weaving would take place. And that would go on all night, women, men on those looms. And I said, this is not going to go on. So now we've constructed a 240 hand loom park where it becomes like a, quote unquote, an industrial factory where women or men, whoever they are, weavers, will go in and they hire those looms. They go and weave at full integration, back end to front end, from raw material, production till finishing, packaging and dispatching of goods in one 15 acre plot where I built a 240 loom factory. And now those rooms that were taken up by these looms in those tenements are now for women to do their packing or for the children to live in. So I think development has to be at the core of all of this in many ways. The second is an imperative that we've put in place for skill development. Wherein we bring in people from rural India, give them marketing skills, give them finance skills, and actually place them in a company. So we've heard a lot about vocational training in India, but I think vocational training in it, as the idea espouses, is useless unless you actually connect people to their first job. Because that's when the connectivity to their life starts. And there we've got young girls, 16, 18, 17 years old, who today are speaking English, marketing, finance, and are being connected with Kelvinator or Domino's Pizza or Whirlpool or other companies, and taking them forward in their lives.
Okay.
So I think those are ideas that need to be taken forward.
Sounds like Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas.
No, I would love it. I would love it.
It's a joke.
The difference between the preaching and the actual execution.
Now the things have got nicely heated up.
With the pugilists now in the arena, come on.
It's the opportune time to move on to our second and I think most contentious team. And I have a very brief question. And maybe we'll go in reverse order this time, Shazia first, Atishi after that, and Jyotir after that. What is the basis of Indian nationhood, according to you? What defines us as a nation?
I think we are a republic, a new republic. And I think it's India as a country is really like is one of the most ancient civilizations. What binds us to each other is this social contract, is this decision of us being a republic, and this plurality that we live with is a part of who we are. So when we think of the Vasudeva Kutumbakam, that's us as a people, of people from different religions, different regions, with linguistic differences, with across the caste system, across the spectrum, all united by this old civilizational thread, this thing of India. And the manifestation of that is a constitution, is a rule of law, is the idea that we're a democracy. I think that's what binds us to each other. So we become fellow Indians by that virtue.
Okay, wonderful. Ms. Bandera.
I think that what really defines India as a nation, and I think that as an ideal which we hold close to us, yet we need to aspire to move deeper towards, is the idea of democracy. I think that this is one thing which is very special about India. There are so many countries across Europe which had democracy before India but did not have universal adult franchise. The fact that India in 1947, when it got its constitution, said that every individual has the right to vote irrespective of what gender they are, irrespective of their economic background, which is something that we didn't see in England for many years while its democracy was developing. Yet, I think that while we aspire towards that ideal, I think we must not forget, as I was saying in the previous discussion, that we are a very, very deeply unequal society. I think that as a society, we have the division between haves and have-nots is so deep that everything works for about 5% of the country. Education works for 5%. And we have world-class schools, we have world-class undergraduate degrees for 5%. We have world-class healthcare facilities for 5%. And yet for that remaining 95%, you have deeply inadequate educational infrastructure, deeply inadequate health infrastructure. You have just yesterday in Madhya Pradesh, there was the case in Ratlam of a child who died on the way to the hospital because an ambulance was available. And I think that that is what a democracy really needs to aspire towards, that everyone actually has an equal voice. Because the reality of this Indian democracy is that the person whose voice is heard is not actually the person who votes for a political party, it's actually who funds the political party. So you have Shazia's party who comes into power, or you have Mr. Sindhya's party who comes into power. It's actually their funders, who are largely the same, who actually have policies that are made for the reality of Indian democracy. This is the reason why Aam Aadmi Party is always an overdraft, like many of the students who are sitting here. While democracy is an ideal we aspire to, whom does it actually work for? And as leaders, we need to think about whom should it actually be working for? Because it's not rocket science to provide healthcare to everyone. It's not rocket science to make sure that your schools work. It's not rocket science to make sure that there's drinking water, that there's electricity, that there's public transport. And yet it hasn't happened in so many years of Indian independence.
So
and I think that is the question that needs to be
sorry.
Asked.
I didn't mean to interrupt you. So I've discerned three elements so far in the two responses. One is constitutional patriotism, the other is diversity, And the third is the constant quest for equality. Now, before I give it to Mr. Sindhya, to be frank, I mean, we all know that we are living in the age of Hindutva ascendancy and of a kind of perhaps a very fundamental transformation of Indian politics, which has implications for the nature of the Indian state. So maybe you could, given that you represent the Grandwood Party, you could weigh in on that, in addition to what you were already planning to say.
See, the biggest concern for me right now, you know, there's a lot that's been mouthed out here. Right of participation. To me, and I've heard from my good friend Adishri about, you know, how the Aam Aadmi is different. The Aam Aadmi being in government still functions like the opposition, and believes in if the bureaucrats don't listen one way, then you've got to slap them across the head to make them sure that they listen the other way. So let's not start getting preachy over here. But I do believe that. I think the fundamental concern for each one of us as an Indian today is that if you go back to the strings of the conversation that you just heard, the fact that we are an old civilization, I can add many homilies to that, the fact that we are a country that has given birth to four religions, and no other country has in civilization across the world, and so on and so forth. But to me, as a younger Indian, I think the one big red flag for me today in our country is the concept of tolerance towards intolerance. And I do believe fundamentally the fact that you may have diverse opinions, diverse views, you've got to respect people's views, because it's when that coming together of different views, different thoughts takes place, that really the manthan and the amrit comes out of the democracy. And that's how we're very different from many other countries in the world. We may take a little longer to come up with our policies or what we believe is right for India going forward, but it's based on consensus building, taking people's views along. And you may not agree with everyone's views, and that's fine. You may agree to disagree, but you cannot impose yourself on everyone in our country and say, you know what, it's either my way or the highway. And what's concerning to me is when you have people in responsible positions either making irresponsible statements or behaving irresponsibly, and then there is no ticking off that happens, or there's no putting down that happens of those statements or those actions, then that leads to a herd mentality, which is what you've seen with cow vigilantism in India, which is what you've seen with the atrocities against Dalits. And what used to be the fringe in India, always used to be the fringe, then transforms itself into the mainstream. And that to me is of concern. So whereas in a auditorium at the LSE, what is important is economic growth and unemployment and or employment for that matter, or manufacturing growth. To me, equally as an Indian, my soul is very troubled when I actually see that diversity of thought and opinion in a country that has always believed in that since its inception, not since independence, but for the last 3,000 years, starts getting trampled upon. That to me is something, is antithetical to my civilizational thesis, but most importantly to me as a Hindu, to the concept of Hinduism. Because Hinduism is not a religion, it is a philosophy, it is a way of life. And when a very calculated, cold calculated way of thought comes in to be able to take that path of Hinduism to a much more militant form, that to me is very antithetical to my religion. And that is of extreme concern to me as an Indian. So whether you've had journalists who have been acted against, authors that have been acted against, across the board in India, I think there's got to be respect for dissent. Because it is dissent that keeps us on our toes. It is dissent that actually keeps all of you on your toes in whatever leadership position that you're in. It's actually dissent that will keep Professor Ghose on his toes in your classroom, right? When you write his 360 degree feedback after your class, after your term finishes.
Right. Ms. Yes.
So I agree with my co-panelist, my friend Jyotiraditya Sindhya. Dissent indeed is the bedrock of democracy. Manufactured dissent is not. The old narrative of the secularism versus communalism has become so hackneyed because facts and history tells us otherwise. Look at the history of communal riots in India that have happened on the Congress watch. Talking about intolerance and tolerance, let's look at the Shah Bano case. Let's look at what happened to Salman Rushdie. Let's happen to what happened to Taslima Nasreen, you would want to know, all on the watch of secularism. That the freedom of expression must be there, but one has to succumb to a certain kind of appeasement for World Bank politics. Whether it's opening of the locks of Ram Mandir or having an executive ordinance reverse a Supreme Court judgment where a 72-year-old Muslim woman would be denied maintenance only to appease the mullahs and vote banks is what the ruling grand old party has indulged in. If you look at the history of communal rioting, even in Gujarat during Madhav Rao Solanki's time, because when Gujarat riots happened, there was television and you saw what happened. But not just the Sikh riots, but I'm talking about as recent as the Aligarh riots or Muzaffarnagar riots. They've all happened on the watch of not just Congress, but so-called secular parties. And now I want to speak not just as an Indian. Can I? I speak not just as an Indian, but as a Muslim and as a woman. For years, I've been a journalist, and I was part of this whole left liberal, I would call them left fascist and illiberal liberals many times. Not talking about all of you, but some of them. And I was surprised that, you know, if you see the socio-economic indices and reports constituted, commissions constituted by the Congress Party, such as Rajinder, such a report, you would see that Muslims and Dalits fared the worst in the so-called secular governments. Whether it was representation of jobs, whether it was inclusion, financial inclusion, social inclusion, access to macro credit facilities, sanitation, healthcare, education, and what have you. Our narrative has been created that you talk about how evil BJP is, how evil RSS is, and how pious, you know, the secularists are, and keep indulging in an act of corruption. When you have an Ujjwala Yojana, where 21,000 crores are saved, and lakhs of women, poor women benefit. When you have Mudra Yojana, when you have all these schemes, and when you have cash direct transfers, you realize that whether it's a Hindu or a Muslim, they all have access to the same policies. When you have for the first time something like Jan Dhan Yojana, where everybody has an access, you have what is called social inclusion and financial inclusion. So this is the reality. Again, it is just not talking and creating a narrative, but living it and implementing it. There should be no discrimination in terms of making a policy and implementing it. And that's why, I think that's the reason why BJP is winning state after state after state. Today again has been a great day for BJP. Just like when I was here last time, and I think it's great, LSE should keep inviting me, because last time I was here, we won UP with a resounding victory which had never happened before. And I was told there were so many Muslim women who actually voted for the BJP. And if you see now, the linguistic minorities, the regional minorities, the tribal minorities are voting for the BJP. So indeed, there is something about, you know, talk is easy, talk is cheap, but the old narrative just won't work. There's got to be more than that. And that is performing, governing, administering, doing it the right way, following the rule of law. And not just appeasing a particular a community for vote bank politics. It has to be actual growth related implementation.
Thanks a lot. I'll give it to Ms. Marlena, who's representing a party that is about 4 or 5 years old. In contrast to the two other speakers who are representing parties formed respectively in 1885 and 1951. So maybe she has a different perspective from both. We'll see.
I think, first of all, it's quite ironic that I think that Shazia from the BJP is justifying that what the BJP is doing is okay because the Congress did it too. And I think that we as a country just cannot...
Atishi obviously didn't hear what I said.
We just cannot justify the fact that just because there were riots under Congress's watch, it's okay what happened in Gujarat. And it's just because Muzaffarnagar happened under X party, it's okay that it happens under Y as well. I don't think anybody said that, number one. But I do agree with Shazia in the fact that I think that the root of a lot of the majoritarianism that we see in India, and I have to say, it is definitely a very, very ugly reality. It is an ugly reality in the fact that a lot of people, friends, students, etc., who are Muslims, today feel embarrassed to say that they're Muslims. They're wanting to change their second names. They're worried about what they eat in public. They're worried about what they wear. And this is definitely not the country that I have grown up in. But I do agree with Shazia that I think that the roots of a lot of this does lie under the Congress's policies, who did create a situation of vote bank politics without actually addressing the core concerns of the Muslim community. And as you said, the Satchar Committee report does show that there's not enough educational facilities, there's not access to jobs, there's not access to credit, there's not access to healthcare. But you did create a perception that you had a ruling party that was interested only in vote bank politics and supporting the Muslims. And so what you're seeing today, what is being fueled by the BJP, is the reaction or response to that. The people who are going into the Bajrangals, the people who are engaging in lynching, their problem is not that they are just against Muslims. Their core problems are that they don't have education, they don't have jobs, and they are being made to believe that the problem is the Muslims. And we have seen exactly this in Europe in the 1930s with the Jews, that the entire narrative created by the Nazis was, your problem is you don't have jobs, you don't have education because of the Jews. And we are seeing that again in India right now, and I think that this is something that should be worrying all of us as a nation, that a lot of the young people who don't have education, who don't have jobs, who don't have access to social mobility, are being told that none of this is because the government is not providing you facilities. All of this is because of this community, and if you lynch them and if you go after them, all is going to be well. And I think that this is something that as young people, and all of us who are sitting on this stage, should be something that we should be really worried about as a country.
Mr. Sindhya, to briefly respond, and then we can move on to the...
I think, you know, the time has come in India where... You know, even as a public servant, you've got to actually look within yourself. And I know I'm hearing a lot on this panel today that so-and-so did so-and-so wrong and so-and-so did so-and-so wrong. And the ball has just been bounced around. And I think it's important that today India is looking for leaders with a difference that will call what is right, right, and what will call what is wrong, wrong, irrespective of which party was responsible for it, and which party should bite the bullet on it. And I think that's what we need to do in India today. And many people have asked me on multiple panels about the Sikh riots. I think it's a blot on our country's history. Many people have asked me about the emergency, and I think it's something that's completely, completely wrong. And I don't think anyone can accept that as a fact today. But I don't think any of my co-panelists will talk about what has been done under their watch with the same alacrity, with the same truth. And I think it's important that we're able to do that today, because I really believe, and I agree to a limited extent with what Atishi said, that it's important in India to identify the root cause. And I think the root cause today in many ways is employment. And I'm talking about not only employment for those that are necessarily not even, don't have access to education facilities, but also the educated. The biggest tragedy in India today is you have educated unemployed. So for all the schemes that my good friend Shazia is talking about, whether it was Jandhan, and I'm not going to go back and say Jandhan was started by the Congress Party, which it was, but I don't want to even go there, right? Because that's what they do all the time. Talk about the Ujwala Yojana or Rajiv Gandhi Gramin Udhikaran Yojana, which just turned around to Deen Dayal Yojana. So there's been just renaming of schemes that's been going on here, right, for the last 4 years.
What about execution and implementation?
Shazia, let's not interrupt each other. So I give you your space, I give you my space. You know, I have the right to say that you have the right to disagree with me, and I respect that. So I think it's important to be able to provide those employment opportunities. And for a prime minister that went around saying that I'm going to generate 2 crore jobs a year, what's the track record been of this government? The last 4 years, you provided between 4 lakh jobs a year to 2 lakh jobs a year to 1.35 lakh jobs a year. You've got 8 lakh engineers coming out of engineering school in India every year. Only 40% of them get employment. Only 47% of MBAs get a job. Right? You've got close to about 30,000 people in China getting a job on a daily basis. Only 450 in India. You're 1.5% of China. 13 million people, 1.3 crore people get employed on an annual basis in China. 2 lakhs in India, not even 2%. That is really the core tragedy in India. And it's great to say, you know, economic growth and all that. And I don't want to get into jargon of data, because if you look at the Congress government that has produced a CAGR, compounded annual growth rate of 7.8% over a 10-year period, right? That's what's actually turned and revolutionized our country, moved us into a $2 trillion economy. You had agriculture growing at 3.8% over a 10-year period. Today you've got agriculture in a disastrous mess. Farmers committing suicide every day. Farmers from Tamil Nadu coming to Jantar Mantar with the bones of their compatriots. Not a single minister of this government even bothering to go there. So the apathy that you're talking about, I'm talking about, we are a country that is very emotionally driven. When you have incidents like Una, where Dalits are beaten up, and not a single minister in this government talks about it. When you have members of parliament saying that you're either a Ramzada or, I'm not even going to use that word, right? And that's a member of parliament. When you have a member of parliament saying Nathuram Godse was a Deshbhakt, and not a single word being said. When on the garb of opposition to a movie, you have people terrorizing kids in a school bus. Kids, 8 years old, 10 years old. Not a single word from the Prime Minister.
Okay, yeah.
Right? That to me is concerning.
Yeah. I think we've got it. In a way, I think we've moved onto the third team, you know, thanks to you. The whole world knows about India's, you know, youth demographic and the great potential that it presents. However, has this been overhyped in recent years, and perhaps in not entirely responsible ways? I don't know. That's my question to you. And are we really looking realistically at a fabulous, you know, demographic dividend, or are we looking down the barrel of a demographic disaster? You know, given the issues of employment and providing, and prior to that, providing good quality education and training to not just millions but hundreds of millions of young people. So Shazia first, and then Atishi, and then.
So if you see the trajectory where the BJP goes, and its political growth, so to speak, you will realize that the growth essentially, the vote share, it is essentially the young voters and the rural voters and the more poorer of the lot are veering towards BJP as opposed to yesteryears. Because ideally, it was Congress was the ideal party. So there is a huge shift happening simply because of one simple thing. There are many schemes, and there have been there before that, and I would give Congress that, for having devised and designed some brilliant schemes. But for the first time, there's a whole overhauling of the machinery. There's a moving and a cracking of the whip with democracy goals, where goal outcomes are being looked at very seriously, which is the reason why the younger lot, why the youth and the marginalized are moving towards BJP, because this was not the traditional vote bank of the BJP. I disagree with the Jyoti Aditya on several counts. You know, there was an actual apology, and by none less than the Prime Minister. It was stated in the Parliament when this abhorrent utterance about Ram Zade and the other was said. Not just that, and not just once, but in three separate addresses, there was this talk of cow vigilantism, and very strict admonishing by the Prime Minister, and it was as tough as it could ever be. So the fact of the matter is that there is a perception that BJP is bedeviled with. And somewhere there is a disconnect between intelligentsia and the people. While the regular folks see the intention of the government, of this particular Prime Minister and his cabinet to deliver, there is still the bias of baggage or the old narrative haunting the perception of BJP. And I must say there is a huge disconnect there. You see state after state after state. You see the vote share and the constituency of BJP change. We are looking at the youth. If you see the Tripura victory, for instance, and I can tell you the youngest team was there actually working with the BJP, which went to Tripura. It is a new kind of politics. It is transformative in many ways, and it's very innovative. The kind of many things, whether it's digital India or startup India, is being done, and there is result. You see SoftBank, you see Oracle, you see Google. Look at this kind of startup, look at the investments happening because of that. So I will not take away the credit of a huge growth rate where the Congress goes, but riddled with a lot of corruption, a lot of scams. I must say that at the level of the center, at the level of the Prime Minister and the cabinet, some amazing work is happening, whether it's rural electrification, whether it's a new Modi care, and a new vision is being created which is actually undermining the caste communal overtones, blurring those boundaries, and looking at a pan-Indian growth where the civic consciousness is being invoked in asking for a better deal for yourself, which includes financial inclusion, which leads to, I think, social inclusion in many, many different ways. That is the way to go, instead of the other way around.
Okay, Atishi, and then Jyotiraditya, and then we'll bring the formal part of the panel to a close.
I
want to leave a few minutes at least for Q&A.
I wouldn't respond to anything specific that Shazia was saying. But I think that there's sometimes just such a grave disconnect between the reality of what we are seeing in terms of BJP's policies, the actions that are happening in its watch, and the sort of things that its spokespersons are talking about. And I think that that is something that in terms of the youth who is sitting here before us, I think that it's a very simple and old adage that actions speak louder than words. And I think we can all see the actions. We can see the actions in terms of the cow lynchings. We can see the actions in terms of the lack of freedom of expression. One can see the actions in terms of what happens when Padmavati becomes Padmavat, and yet no one is able to watch it. And I think that this is something that as the youth of the country, we should be thinking about. And I think that while yes, I do agree with you that the demographic dividend may be an extremely overhyped word, but I almost see the demographic dividend sitting right in front of me. And since this is a politics panel, I would actually like to end what I have to say in this panel more with an urge to many of the youth who are sitting here. I think that politics has often been seen as a bad word. I think that in across the country, and many of us have done it in the past, it's almost cool to abuse politicians, and politics is bad, and politics is dirty. And if anyone who is well-educated thinks of going into politics, you're like, no. And I think that this is something that really needs to change. And yes, politics is dirty. I am not denying that. And I think that often in politics, there are times when the choices are only between bad and worse. And that is probably not something that we think is a sanitized choice, and we think we would rather have a six-figure or seven-figure salaries as we have them. But I think we all need to understand that politics is the thing that affects our lives the most. And if we let politics be in the hands of people whom we regard as highly problematic and who are making wrong decisions, I think that it is our responsibility as young people and as our responsibility as future leaders of this country to come forward and possibly take charge of it. And I remember used the expression that said, politics to gutter ki tarah hai. Like, politics is as dirty as a gutter. Yes, it is. But if you have to clean it, you will really have to get into it, get your hands dirty, and then only can you think about cleaning it. And that would be my urge sort of across party lines to all the young people who are sitting here, that the most important decisions that affect our lives are made by politicians. And if we let those decisions be made by people who we are not even willing to let into our living room, then what kind of a country are we creating? So it is incumbent upon all of you to step forward, to consider participating in the public domain, in political life, if you
really want to change our country.
So we were talking about the youth dividend, and I really do believe that that is something that sets us apart from any other nation in the world. The very fact that you've got 70% of India below the age of 35. We're talking about almost 800 million people. Right? But my concern, as Professor said, is that you don't want this demographic dividend turning into India's demographic nightmare. And when you have, going back to the economics of it, when you have savings growth, savings rates falling, you have investment rates falling, you have the lowest investment in the last quarter in the past 13 years in India, when you have projects that are being stored close to about 13.2 trillion rupees worth of projects still being stored, when you have notions such as Startup India and Skill India, which are notionally very, very good ideas, funded well, with a corpus of 10,000 crores, for example, for Startup India. But do you know what the result has been? In the last 4 years, you had 377 crores only being allocated to 75 startups out of a corpus of 10,000 crores. So there's many a slip between the cup and the lip. When we talk about Skill India, that was the National Skill Development Mission that was started in our tenure, right? Again, a great idea. This government put together a very, very strong target. 50 crore people need to be skilled by 2022. We're 4 years down the curve. In the last 4 years, you've had a total of 1.6 crore people being skilled. And now that mission has been shut down. So when you have investment rates falling, when you have savings rates falling, when you have agriculture and manufacturing getting completely jammed, as it is today in India, when you have Indian companies investing more in projects abroad than within the country, those are all telltale signs which are very alarming, because when that happens, then the consumption cycle starts to evaporate. When the consumption cycle starts to evaporate, then companies start concentrating on cutting costs rather than boosting top lines. And when you start wanting to cut costs, then you're not increasing employment opportunities, but actually decreasing employment opportunities, which is what's happened in India over the last 4 years. And that's the statistic I gave you. As opposed to a 2 crore target, you're only developing 2 to 3 lakh jobs per year. Couple that with demonetization and GST, which has led to a complete hemorrhage in the unorganized sector of employment opportunities. So again, these are extremely worrying signs. And today, for every young aspirational Indian, it's everyone wants to get forward and create a better life for themselves than their parents had. And that can only be done when you have a plethora of employment opportunities that are created. We led with the services sector, but India cannot keep leading with the services sector unless you have the manufacturing sector also growing at that pace. And then again comes the challenge of moving people from agriculture to manufacturing services, because 60% of employment comes from a sector that contributes only 16% to GDP. So you've got to transition people to manufacturing services. So there has to be a very clear-cut economic roadmap, not only for economic growth, but also for creating employment opportunities. And to the point that Atishi made, I cannot second her enough. I think sitting on the outside, it's very easy to criticize what public servants do. But I think you have to become the change you want to see in the world. And I know many of you think it's dirty, but it's only when you actually put your hands in that you can change the environment that you deal with. And it's not only about policy making, but it's also about making a difference in even a single person's life. And if you're able to change that, then that, I believe, is a life certainly worth living. Thank you.
We can go and enter the formal part of the panel. We do have very little time for one or two questions. There are too many hands. How do I? This is understandable. It's been a very vigorous discussion. But how do I select people? Everyone put up their hands at the same time. What about you over there? Yes. Please be very brief and ask your question succinctly.
So
so many questions. Okay, we can do that. Go on.
My question is to all the candidates. Do you think that political parties use attributes such as caste and religion to actually seek votes? And because to me, as an Indian citizen, when I look at the ruling government or the government who's not ruling also, I feel like there is a business plan going on, and the people are trying to sell their products. And I'm offering you this much discount, and the other one is like, I'm offering you this much discount, come here and you come here. So I kind of feel that it's just products being sold, and there's actually no proper execution and implementation, because between the layers it's just lost.
That question is about what we academics call populism. There are two young gentlemen over there. The one in the blue suit, first.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Shaiya Sadhu, the Vice President of the Montfort University Student Union. And my question is to Mr. Sindhia. Sir, first of all, many congratulations on your tremendous victory in both Kolarat and Mangavli.
Thank you.
And sir, my question to you is, for a long time now, we have been debating about tolerance and intolerance in India. Sir, shouldn't we at this point of time talk about acceptance rather than focusing on tolerance, because acceptance precisely inculcates more positivity in it? And my second question to you is, both Mr. Rahul Gandhi and you believe in giving chance to youth in politics, but sir, when it comes to give tickets to youth in the election, they are often being denied and told that they lack experience. So what are you doing in both of these?
Age hierarchy. I think we can't take all of the questions, but the one just behind the previous question.
So this panel has been a whirlwind of emotions for me. Some things make me happy and optimistic about the future of our country, but then every 10 seconds, someone from one party will take a shot at the other party. I mean, what do you think about cross-party collaboration, and what can be done to improve it without playing a blame game to the other political parties?
Excellent question. Thank you.
Okay, so three quick questions. One about caste and religion and populism, second about youth, and third about collaboration. All three great buzzwords, but I believe that India really today needs people who can translate ideas into reality. I think there are millions of people who give you great ideas. What's the difference between a successful startup and one that's not? It's not that one is bereft of ideas and the other isn't. It's one that executes an idea well. And I think in the area of governance, not necessarily politics, and by governance I don't necessarily mean you need to be in government for governance. I've been in opposition for 6 out of 16 years of being in politics at the center, and 15 out of 16 years in being in politics in my state, right? But I do believe that if people have entrusted you with their future for 5 years, you have a responsibility to make a difference. And that responsibility is not only by being a lawmaker sitting in parliament, but that responsibility is by actually making a difference on the ground. You've got to bring about a different paradigm that has not been done in that area before. So to your point, yes, India is about politics, is about religion, politics is about caste. But if you believe that politics has to be about development, then don't speak it. Live it, breathe it, and action it. And when you go to your people, talk about what is it that you have done to make their lives better. And make them understand how you have changed their lives away from a caste politics or away from a religion politics. I come from a caste that out of 1.8 million voters in my constituency, I don't even have 1,000 people of my caste. But I believe in a politics that you have two types of netas in India, right? One is a neta, going back to your point, that promises a lot, but at the end of 4 years, delivers jack. Right. And the other is a neta that doesn't promise very much, but goes back with 10 times more than what he had said. And I try and follow the footsteps of my father, and I try and be the latter Neta rather than the former Neta. Great. I believe that your track record must speak to yourself. To your point about youth, it is in many ways ironic, because you have a tremendous youth bulge in our country, a demographic dividend, but still in politics, it's either gray hair or no hair. But I think you've got to persevere. And if you persevere beyond a point, like in business, you cannot be ignored. Even in politics, you cannot be ignored. Make your voice heard, and don't necessarily utter the right things that should be said, but what you believe in from the core of your heart. Because that's what you're going to go to bed with in terms of your conscience. Right? And to your point, I think there was a time in India that there was a tremendous amount of collaboration between not only government and opposition, but across the board. I've grown up in an India in the 80s when I used to accompany my father on tours, where my father would have people from the opposition sitting on the same bench, and they both would be praising each other. In parliament, you have the most vitriolic debates, but then when you stepped out of parliament, a lot of people would be best friends. But today, you're sleeping with the enemy if you're doing that, right? And I think we need to bring that process back into our politics, where you may be a leader in the opposition, but because you believe what you stand in, I have a great amount of respect for you, and I will say that on a public platform, and I will not shy away from that. And I think that goes back again to the point that I have made time and time again on this panel over the next 1 hour, that speak from your heart, not from your head. And I think that's what India needs the most.
Great. Feel free to select which question you want to respond to. You wouldn't have responded to all of them necessarily, but it's up to you. We are out of time, so we are running on extra time post the 90 minutes.
I think the question on caste and religion and politicians selling different things. Sitting in the London School of Economics, so supply and demand really comes to my mind as a sort of comparison to democracy. And I think that in many ways, I think it's not you as citizens who should be asking us as politicians questions. I think it's us as politicians who should be asking citizens, because I think it's citizens who actually shape democracy. So our democracy is what people shape it to be. So if you think that your politicians have a problem, if you think your politicians are selling religion, or your politicians are selling caste, or your politicians are selling populism, it's because we are creating the demand for it. If the public demands the right things, if you demand education, if you demand employment, if you demand healthcare, and if your representative knows that they cannot come back to you after 5 years unless they have actually fulfilled their demands, and they know that they are not going to be elected back, they will jolly well do everything that they actually should be doing. So I think that the responsibility for making our democracy work, for making our democracy move beyond caste, move beyond religion, beyond populism, lies with everyone. And I think we cannot excuse ourselves by just blaming the bad politicians, because we as citizens are shaping our democracy as well. And I think that that is what I would like everyone in the room to think about, that what is the kind of politicians we get, what is the kind of governance we get, depends on what is the questions we are asking them.
Shazia?
I really do believe, and I like that question very much about cross-collaboration. I think that kind of cohesiveness has to be there, not just a confrontationless attitude. I'm happy for the fact that on the GST, which is first being criticized now, but all parties were members of that great collaboration that happened, and finally we have a fantastic reform. The GST implementation is going on, and you can see the great effects of it, and Congress and other parties work together to create that, of course. It was Congress's original idea, and it went further, it was taken. I also feel like on issues, like for instance, triple talaq, a topic very close to my heart, simply because BJP is going to do a good thing, which will change the lives of Muslim women, there should not be opposition for the sake of it. Some things are beyond party politics. We as people, whichever party we come from, after all, owe our allegiance to people and a country and a larger thought and an idea than than just a party. I wish we saw more that of, instead of just following close party lines that we see, especially when it comes to the opposition to some good bills that should be there. Road safety is one of the big bills. I mean, people don't talk about it, but the fact of the matter is that Nitin Gadkari was at the heart of it. Maximum deaths are caused by road accidents in our country, but it's hardly ever discussed. Second, and mostly I need to say this here, that, you know, we must cease to be just members of a party or voters of a particular party. Because we are, as a society, so divided, so deeply communal, casteist, feudal in nature, our politics simply reflects what we are as a people. Because if there is a constituency for, let's say, Jat votes or Ahir votes or Kurmi votes or Dalit votes or what have you, what politicians will follow that. So it is a simple demand and supply dynamics at the end of it. So politics will change also by the nature of the voters. And that is very, very important. And I really do think that there has to be less of confrontation, blame game, and for some good things that are good for the country, good for its minorities or its people, marginalized sections, parties must work together and not just look at electoral gains in the offing.
I couldn't agree more. It's a civility issue, but much more important, it's cross-party collaboration is essential for progressing the development agenda, as you say. Now, I've been signaled to wrap things up. Unfortunately, we can't take further questions. Please do bear with me and understand, you know, why. I can understand your disappointment, but I think at least two of our speakers have to leave very soon. I think Atishi will be around, so in case you want to talk to her, you know, informally, you're very welcome to. There's a Bollywood panel to follow, and, you know, I don't want to keep Bollywood waiting or to keep you, you know, waiting for me. But let me just conclude by saying that I told you an hour and 15 minutes ago that this panel would be well worth your time and the trouble you've taken to come out here on a wintry day. And I suspect that most of you, perhaps all of you, or nearly all of you, will agree with me. And secondly, not to be sycophantic, but I do mean this, you know, semi-sincerely, that I think there's hope yet for Indian politics with such bright and eloquent people involved, cutting across party divides. So please join me in very warm